Okay, welcoming onto the dais the player representatives from South Dakota State. From my left to right, we have Mike Dom, Michael Orris, and Reed Tellinghusen. We ask you that you please raise your hand if you have a question, and we'll bring a microphone to you. And we also ask you to please wait till the microphone is there, and ask you to please identify yourself by name and by media affiliation. And right now, we'll open it up to questions for our student athletes.
Mark Ovenden from KDLT in Sioux Falls. This is for Mike. About midway through the season, you were kind of carrying the load there for a while. What's been the difference in terms of the rest of the team really stepping up?
We've definitely had a ton of guys step up, kind of unexpectedly, with guys like Chris Howell, Mike here, and then Lane Severin was a huge guy. And then, you know, Reed's been doing his thing the whole year, and he's really started to carry a load for our team, too, these past few weeks. So it's just been guys jumping on opportunities when they get them and stepping up in big moments.
Brad Rock from the Deseret News here in Salt Lake. This is for any of you gentlemen. Have you ever looked at Gonzaga? You've certainly been to the NCAA tournament in recent years. Do you look at Gonzaga and say, that is a program that we'd like to be, there someday?
I mean, obviously, they've had plenty of success. They're good over year in, year again. They're a great mid-major. They're top 25 mid-major programs each year. So, you know, we'd eventually like to get to be that way, and hopefully someday South Dakota State can be that program.
Yeah, going on that too, I mean, I agree. You see them year in and year out that they're always in the NCAA tournament. They're always on top of the mid-majors, and if we could battle them for that spot any way that we can, I mean, I think that'd be great.
Matt Zimmer, Argus Leader. Michael Orris, can you talk a little bit about how Mike Dom has kind of lived up to what maybe you were expecting when you came here for 1 year, knowing that he was kind of the special player on this team?
Yeah, absolutely. Mike had a bunch of accolades coming in already, and obviously that was a big vocal point for me coming here. He even did some recruiting to get me here. Both of these guys did. And Coach TJ talking about what it would be like to be in a pick-and-roll situation, which is kind of my niche and what I do, and having him be able to pop or roll or do all those things. And, I mean, he's living up to it day in and day out. And what I appreciate about Mike is that he doesn't live into the hype or doesn't pay attention to it all or let it get to him. You know, he's just out there playing basketball and having fun, as we all are. And I just think at the end of the day, Mike is doing what he does best, and he sticks to that. He's going to always be successful.
Ellie Nathan, KSFY Sports. Now this is for Reed. A big theme for you guys throughout the season has been just trusting the process and focusing on getting better the next day. How has that contributed to this team's success down the stretch here, and why is it even more valuable at a tournament like this?
Yeah, I mean, just focusing on the task at hand. You know, we try to get better each day, each drill, each day at practice, and, you know, just doing what we do best. Getting better at those things, and you know it's been good for us so far, and you know we've had some success from that.
Mike, we talked about the fact that other guys have stepped up from about midway through the season, but you're going to have a big game tomorrow. Are you excited about that challenge?
I definitely am. You know, this is the best time of the year, best experience I've been in since last year when I got to come back to the NCAA tournament, and then coming back this year. It really has just been an amazing experience. You know, I'm not even looking at any of the matchups, anything like that. I'm just going to go out and play and have fun.
This is for all three of you guys. Carter Williams, KSL.com. You've had a couple games so far this year in high altitude, and that may play a factor again with this tournament playing here in Salt Lake City. How does it help to have the experience playing in high altitude?
I think it definitely helps us. You know, I mean, we run every single day. We're in shape. And by this time in the season, you know, our bodies just find a way to get through things. So I think looking at that doesn't really affect us.
Hey, Michael. Teddy Greenstein from the Chicago Tribune. How did your time at Northern Illinois prepare you for this? And why did you choose South Dakota State in the first place?
Yeah, I think every stop that I had along the way kind of prepared me for all of this. You know, being at Kansas State my freshman year, I got to experience an NCAA tournament, although I didn't get to play. And then Northern, just kind of getting on the floor again, getting back into the routine and getting coached by a coach that has been to Final Four with Michigan State, who has been a point guard himself and went to the Final Four. Being under that coach and learning from him and just kind of getting that in-game experience led me to here. And Coach TJ has done an unbelievable job of giving me the freedom to run this team and have the keys to be the coach on the floor and just be an extension of him and kind of make this ship afloat and make sure we don't sink. So it's been amazing, and I couldn't ask for to be in a better spot, a better position with all these guys around me.
David Brown, Midco Sports Network. I'd like all three of you to answer if you could. We in South Dakota obviously have covered the slow start you guys had to the Summit League season, but what I'm wondering is, was there ever a time during that slide that basketball stopped being fun? Did you have to sort of recapture the fun aspect of basketball, and if so, how did you do it?
No, I don't think it ever stopped being fun. I mean, we're playing with a great group of guys. All of us love each other and, you know, care so much about each other. And, you know, we love hanging out with each other. So, you know, we obviously were fighting adversity, and we knew we had to change some things. And I'm just so proud of our guys for stepping up, doing the right thing, and finally turning the season around.
I think the biggest thing was just is frustration, because we all knew how good we could be. We all loved each other so much and wanted to, you know, have success for each other, not just for ourselves. And just the frustration setting in of, like, why is it not happening? Why is it not clicking? I think that is what hit the most. But I don't think the fun ever came out of it. It just really made us have our backs against the wall and see what we were made of to fight out of it or fold.
And just kind of going off what Mike and Reed said, you know, it was just the guys' tenacity to stick with the team, stick with each other, and stick with the coaches. We never really got down on each other, so it never made it less fun when we were going through that stretch of losing, but we always had our backs against the wall, and we always found a way to fight our way out of it. So,
Kareem Copeland, Associated Press. Michael, what stands out when you watch tape of Williams Goss, and without giving away the house secrets, what do you guys do to slow him down?
You know, he's a tremendous player, tremendous point guard. Obviously, you know, his national recognition speaks for himself. I think he's an unbelievable guard in transition, and his mid-range floater game is definitely big time. Just slowing him down, make sure he doesn't get downhill, is our biggest priority, and I'm really looking forward to this challenge.
Kind of piggybacking off that for Mike Dom, the Zags have terrific backcourt play, a couple seven-footers up front, balanced with 10 guys that are five guys that score 10 points. What do you think the biggest challenge is tomorrow, or the biggest difficulty that the Bulldogs present outside of just trying to go have fun?
Well, their guard play is tremendous, like Michael said, with Goss and you know, their big man inside. We're going to have to do a tremendous job of just keeping it out, and if not keeping it out, it's just pushing him out further so he has a longer way to the basket. That's definitely going to be a challenge for us, but we've always looked at challenges this year and kind of said bring them on.
Sam Adams from SWX in Spokane. For you, Mike, you mentioned on the offensive end or the defensive end. How about offensively for you going up against a defensive unit at Gonzaga that really prides itself on defense this year, specifically Shimmick Karnowski? We're going up again. It's the guy who's 7'1", and he can stretch the floor and even guard the perimeter a little bit.
Yeah, no, he's a great defender from the film that we've watched, and I'm super excited. You know, coach is going to have us on the move the whole time, so it'll just be fun to see us all over the court, see how they defend us with what we're going to be throwing at them.
As for Reed, talk about the play again of everybody else, because it seems like as a team, you guys have really elevated yourself. If they were to reseed you on how you've been playing the last half of the year, you'd probably be a 12 seed like you were last year. It's kind of amazing what's happened here.
Yeah, I mean, so many guys have stepped up as of late. You know, we had a whole new coaching staff, a bunch of new guys, a bunch of transfers coming in. So, you know, we kind of had those bumps in the road. And I think we're just finally, throughout the Summit League, we started to gel better. And our guys started stepping up. Everyone got more familiar with each other. And, you know, that's what kind of led to our success.
Mike, you know, you've been on ESPN a couple times. You had the highest scoring game in the nation this year. Can you talk a little bit about just what it's been like to have that spotlight on you individually this season and how you've dealt with that?
It's for sure been fun. You know, that's everything you dream about, you know, scoring big games, being on ESPN, things like that. But none of that stuff has ever really gotten to my head. It's obviously been great exposure for South Dakota State, for our program. It's a great recruiting tool for the coaches to use that. So it's just been a blessing to be able to go through it all and be a part of it with a great team.
Eddie Pels from AP. Michael, kind of an indelicate question, but the tragedy you went through with your brother, where did it put basketball in your list of important things, or how did it help you?
When something like that happens in life, everything else becomes less important, and your whole perspective on life changes. It has radically changed my life, radically changed my world. But basketball, at the end of the day, was a constant thing between my older brother and myself. And to be here on this stage, to be doing this right now without him is extremely difficult, but this is what he dreamed of for me. This was his dream for my life, and I'm going to go out and honor it the best way I know how.
Okay, we have time for a couple more questions. We'll start with that one right there.
David Brown again. This is for Mike, Dom, and Reed. Simple stat, but Coach always talks about win the rebounding battle, win the game. Was there a point of emphasis on rebounding later in the season? I mean, sometimes balls, you know, they just take a funny bounce off the rim and you can't get the board, but how did you improve the rebounding over the course of the season?
Yeah, no, that was definitely a big emphasis. You know, at the start of the year, we were trying to kind of figure out what was wrong while we were losing. We didn't really look at rebounding aspect part of it. We were just going by turnovers, and then we started just out-rebounding guys, and then our net record was just like staggering, like 14-1 right now if we out-rebound our opponents. And next thing you know, in practice, that's what we were hammering on, was rebounding. So every game is just a fight. You know, no matter what momentum swing is going on, just try to rebound the best you can.
And I think it goes back to that game in Omaha when we were playing them at their place. I think we beat them by 15 or so on the boards. And I think since then, our guys have really put a focus on rebounding. And, you know, that's been one of the main focuses in order to win the game.
Okay. Thank you. And congratulations on making it to the tournament, and best of luck tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you guys.
Appreciate it. We'll excuse our student athletes. South Dakota State head coach TJ Otzelberger will be on the dais here momentarily. introduce South Dakota State head coach T.J. Otzelberger. We'll start with an opening statement and then open up for questions.
First of all, I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. Couldn't be more proud of our team and everybody that's made this opportunity for us possible. And just excited for this next challenge. Have a tremendous amount of respect for Gonzaga, who they are as a program, what they've accomplished this year, and really excited about this opportunity that's in front of us tomorrow.
John Blanchett from the Spokesman Review. TJ, in teams preparing to face Mike Dom, I imagine you've seen a little bit of everything in defense that they've tried. Have you not seen anything in particular, or have you really seen the whole kitchen sink?
Yeah, I'm not quite sure that we've seen a 7 foot something, 300 and something pound front line guy that could be staring across from him. But we've seen every double team, we've seen every trap. We've seen so many different ways for people to try to stop him or hold him down. Mike's been sensational on staying on the move, being persistent offensively, and having a will where he's going to demand the basketball in tough spots. So he's certainly gifted scoring the basketball, and we feel like we've seen a lot of different looks, and hopefully we're prepared for whatever we see moving forward.
Mark Ovenden from KDLT in Sioux Falls. You've also never seen a team that got that many tall guys. Craig Smith said the other day that he felt like they had like 10 7-footers when USD played them. What do you have to do to play bigger to combat that?
I think overall it's, for us, we're focused on what we've been doing. I think for the last 6 weeks, as we've kind of moved forward with our team and had success, it's been a byproduct of us worrying about how we can be better in what we do. We understand that during the course of the game, there's going to be different lineups and different things that people throw at us. Certainly, we haven't faced a team with as much size as Gonzaga does and the physicality that they have. At the same time, Mike's had so much poise, especially the second half of the season, and scored the ball in so many different spots. We're not going to go away from what's made us successful. We're going to stick to our plan and be willing and ready to adapt during the game if that's what we need to do.
David Brown, Midco Sports in Sioux Falls. You've mentioned repeatedly throughout the back half of the Summit League season, the key is out-rebound your opponent, win the game. So how did you guys improve your rebounding? It's something I asked the players as well over the course of the season, because sometimes balls just take funny bounces. So where does the improvement in the rebounding come from?
You know, I think overall it's just that emphasis. It's continually talking about it. It's not so much as doing drills and beating each other up as the awareness to it, technically being more sound, but having that competitive will. And I think for our guys, there's a lot of teams out there that play well as a group. I'm not sure that anybody plays as together or for each other as our guys have this 6 weeks. Really proud of them for that. And I think there's such a ownership and accountability to each other that they want to get stops and finish plays because they know how important it is for the success of their team. So I think our guys have just made that overall commitment to each other, and obviously as a coach, really proud of them for that.
TJ, what's been your take on Mike's season and the attention he's gotten, just as far as, you know, and obviously it brings a lot of attention to your program, but also just how he's handled that individually, having such a spotlight on him, even on sort of a national level?
Mike handles everything with an unbelievable amount of grace and ease. He's so, as great of a player as he is, you know, he's unbelievable in the community. He's a phenomenal student. He's a heck of a teammate, and he's a great person. And I think that character shows through, especially when you put a spotlight on him, whether it's on the basketball court, whether it's off the court, whether it's in an interview, or whether it's the other attention that comes to him. He handles it with such grace because of who he is. He goes back to his foundation of who he is as a person and his upbringings, and he's continued to just keep his focus on as much attention as he's gotten, what our team needs each game and what he needs to do on the practice floor each day, and he's done a phenomenal job.
Elliot Nathan, KSFY Sports. TJ, Gonzaga's made 19 consecutive trips to the NCAA tournament. In some ways, they've kind of helped raise the profile of mid-major basketball. Do you feel like SDSU aspires to be like Gonzaga in that regard? And what can you guys kind of learn from the way that FIU has built the program that you can take from?
When you look back at their program, whether you go all the way back to Coach Munson and then into Coach FIU, obviously at the mid-major level, and I don't even know if you can consider them a mid-major program anymore with the level of success they've had, you look at them and you say, this is a program that 20 years ago was in a spot where they were trying to build something special. And from that vantage point, that's what we hope to do in Brookings. That's what we hope to do with the Jackrabbits. And obviously there's been some tradition there, and we're trying to get better each day and build on that. And we have a lot of respect for what they've done and how they've built it over time and sustained success. We admire that, and that's something we hope to accomplish. At the same time, there's going to be differences, and there's going to be differences in how we do it. And I'm just excited to keep working with these guys each day. It's a thrill to have. Every day we get to practice at this point forward, we're excited because we feel like we're continuing to build on this season, but also as the growth of our program moving forward.
Kareem Copeland, AP. Coach, just wanted to ask about how did Michael deal with the passing of his brother and just emotionally throughout the season and being able to kind of keep his mind in basketball also?
Michael and his brother, you know, they were best friends. And when he went to Kansas State and then also when he went to Northern Illinois, his brother was right there by his side. They were best friends. So, you know, when I first met Michael, I remember in our first conversation through the recruiting process, we talked about the importance of his brother in his life, his brother's passing, and how much he felt like he was playing for his brother because of the strength his brother provided him as a player and how much he meant to him. And, you know, I'd be foolish to say that what's happened with him through the course of this season, as he's continued to improve and become that coach on the floor for us, that he's not gaining that strength and utilizing that strength from his brother and playing for his brother to some extent. And it's been really awesome to see. And you can tell the sense of pride Michael has that he's on the floor each day. And it's been great to see how he's continued to use that for strength for himself, both on and off the court.
David Brown again. No matter how many times people look at the bracket, even though it's not indicative maybe of the last 6 weeks of your guys' play, people will see the 16 and they'll see the 1. Are you using that as part of the lead-up to this game, or are you telling guys to ignore the numbers?
Yeah, we've been able to play okay here these last 6 weeks because we haven't really worried about any of the noise on the outside. I think we sat in a spot 6 weeks ago where we were dead last in the league that only takes 8 of the 9 teams to the conference tournament. And our guys showed unbelievable fight to come together and continue to move forward. And we haven't done that because we've worried about who's in front of us. We've worried about how together we can be as a group and how we can play for each other. You carry that through our conference tournament. I don't think the seeds mattered. Everybody, once you get to the postseason and the conference tournament, we told our guys we're all 0-0. And we're starting from scratch. And whether you have an 8 by your name or a 1 by your name, in our conference, there's so much parity that there were so many teams that had a chance to win that tournament. And now when you look forward to the NCAA tournament and you go one step further, obviously you keep hearing everybody talk about the numbers and the chances that at some point does a 16 seed win. And for us, our focus is really stayed with just our team and what we need to do. We've got a lot of respect for what Gonzaga's done this year, and they've earned that seed. At the same time, everybody's 0-0. We're coming into this thing. Our guys are playing loose. Our guys are playing aggressive. We have every bit as much right to be in this tournament as any of the other 67 teams do, and we're going to come out tomorrow and play with some passion and show that.
Jacob Thorpe, Spokesman Review. TJ, things have really gone south for Washington since you left, and I'm wondering why you think that is and if you have any thoughts on Lorenzo Romar's future in Seattle.
I think Lorenzo Romar is a tremendous basketball coach. He did an unbelievable job taking a program to new heights that had never been there before, three Sweet 16 performances in that stretch. He's been an unbelievable mentor to me, leader, graduation rate with young men. Everything that he's done there as a head coach has been first class. I know that the wins and losses at this point in recent history aren't where he'd like them to be, But I'm confident in Coach Romar. I appreciate the relationship he's had with me, and hope for him that his future continues at Washington. Because if my son was ever fortunate enough to play college basketball, he'd be blessed to have an opportunity to play for a man that's as good of a person, a leader, and as a coach as Coach Romar.
Hi, Coach. Sam Adams from SWX in Spokane. Kind of following up with your days at Washington, of course, Nigel Williams-Goss with Gonzaga now. Can you tell us about your experience with him, what you think about him as a young man and as a player in your experience?
Much like we talked about Mike Dom earlier, Nigel's one of those guys that his character is off the charts. His work ethic is what's extremely impressive to me because he's such a great worker. He spends countless hours in the gym perfecting his craft. He's gotten to a point where there really isn't much of a weakness in his game, and that's a testament to his hard work and what he's put into it. Working with him each day at Washington, working with the guards for 2 years, and being able to coach him, what you really appreciate is how competitive he is, how much this game matters to him, and how much winning matters to him. And that's he's got so many things physically that he does out there, but it's more that will, it's more that competitive spirit that make him special. So we've talked the last few days with our team as we've prepared about what we need to do to be successful and trying to neutralize him. At the same time, having coached him, I'm very aware that having a plan sounds good and being able to stop him is a whole nother thing.
Obviously, when you came in, it was sort of a hodgepodge. You had some returners, you brought in some JUCO guys, your own guys, but there are some guys on the team with NCAA experience. You have experience as an assistant at Iowa State. Did you, in the preparation for this game, any sort of words of wisdom or just, you know, talking about what the experience is like, both from your assistant coaching perspective and listening to the players from their perspective?
As much as you can, you know, we're trying to look at this as another game that's in front of us. And obviously there's more cameras, there's more attention, there's more social media, there's more things on the news that bring attention to it. We're trying to approach it as another game. And I don't think our guys, and I shouldn't say I don't think, I know our guys aren't just content to be here. We haven't fought out of the hole that we've fought out of to come here and have a moral victory. I'm really excited about how they've continued to work each day, how they've put extra time in together. And so as much as you look at last year and say, well, Mike Dom's played in the NCAA tournament, Reed Tellinghuizen, and on down the line with Ian Tyson and Tevin King, you hope that gives them that extra sense of confidence. But we're trying as much as possible to approach this as another game and take care of the task at hand.
TJ, it's your first year. How enjoyable has it been, rewarding maybe a better word, to see this come together in the last 6 weeks? Because it's been a pretty huge shift in where you're at today in terms of where you're at 3 months ago.
I take a great sense of pride, especially on Sunday at the selection show. It wasn't seeing that logo, the Jackrabbit logo called, that was as much of who do we play or when do we play. It was a lot more the sense of pride I had for all the people that have worked so hard to make it possible. And that's from administration to our student athletes, to our coaches, our managers, people in the community, and our unbelievable fan support and how people came out to support us in Sioux Falls. And that sense of pride, taking that for everybody that was part of it. So I know a lot of people have asked the question, well, this is your first year as a head coach. How great does it feel to get to the tournament? And certainly it's exciting. What I'm more proud of is when you work in a profession where your job is to develop young men on and off the court as student athletes, and you see that growth and development through the course of the season, that's what this is all about. And sometimes the wins line up and sometimes they don't, but I'm really, really, truly proud of the young men in our program for how they've grown, the life lessons they've taken from it and what they've learned, and how this will all help all of us as we move forward and being better people from it. For that, I'm really happy.
Coach, among the transfers, one of them, A.J. Hess, what personally did you see out of him that you wanted him at South Dakota State, and what has he brought the team this season?
Well, first of all, when you looked at our roster, when we came in, we didn't have any seniors returning. So we thought getting some experience, first of all, was really important. So we wanted to make sure as we evaluated, whether it was graduate transfers or junior college transfers, that there are young men that had great character, first of all, that they would fit our culture and the forward-moving you know, us as we move forward as well. And I think, you know, with AJ, could tell very early on that what he wanted out of his college career is to be sitting where we are today. He wasn't fortunate enough at SUU to play in an NCAA tournament. And when I heard him tell his story, I asked him why he would consider an opportunity like South Dakota State. And he said, Coach, you have a program and a culture that's been successful, and that's something that I'm really longing for. And that's something that really hit home for me, because we wanted to create this opportunity and do the best we can to put these guys in position to reach their goals and their dreams. And for AJ to be here truly is a dream. So obviously on the court, he's a phenomenal shooter. He's had some huge shooting games for us. And that's been a big part of helping us be able to space the floor at times. He's been great that way. He's had some big rebounding games for us. So I think far above the basketball ability is how he fits with our guys, and his character is number one to me. But obviously he's a guy that has proven offensively he can have some big scoring nights, and that makes defenses have to make some choices. So fortunate to have AJ that way.
Okay, any further questions? Okay, Coach, thank you very much, and best of luck tomorrow.
Thanks a lot.
Really appreciate it. Thank you. Next up will be the Vanderbilt student athletes at approximately 12:05 p.m., followed by Coach Drew at 12:20. Okay, some housekeeping items on before we start our next press conference. Vanderbilt is the 9 seed. We'll face the number 8 seed Northwestern here at the arena tomorrow at 2:30 p.m. Mountain Time. And that game will be on TBS. The Commodores are an at-large out of the SEC with a record of 19-15.
Bryce Drew. Yep, D-R-E-W.
Yes. And once again, the satellite coordinates for today's press conferences, AMC 15, K12D. Again, that's AMC 15, K12D. Okay, introducing our student athletes from left to right. Senior guard Nolan Kressler, senior forward Luke Cornett, and junior forward Jeff Roberson. And then we'll open up to questions for the student athletes.
Heads up on for tomorrow. What are you expecting?
I think we're expecting it definitely to be a high energy game, and especially just with the circumstances surrounding Northwestern, definitely I assume a lot of alumni and just people are going to try to get coming to the game. I mean, we're excited for it. We've enjoyed playing in road games this year, and if it's like that, then we're more than be ready for it. And I mean, it's going to be a fun atmosphere no matter what, and we're just going to kind of let that energy just carry out on the court.
Adam Sparks, Tennessee. And Jeff, what is the experience of last year going through the NCAA? Is that a help, a hurt? Because obviously you guys didn't play your best game. What's the ramifications of that game on this one?
I think it's a little help because we're aware of how bad we played last year, and we kind of just want to get a redo and play to the best of our ability. So, I mean, coming out and be ready to play, just knowing it's great to be here, but we have a lot of work we want to accomplish. So just being focused on that will help us.
Luke, obviously Matt has kind of had a roller coaster year starting, then on the bench playing well now. What does it say about his demeanor, about where his maturity is, that he's been an asset to this team late in the year?
I mean, it's definitely a great thing. I think every single person on this team, Matt included, I mean, we just all want to go out and just win games, and that's definitely how it's kind of been down the stretch. And I think for any person, whatever role they're going to be put into, our focus is just going out and putting out the best 40 minutes that we can, whatever that role may be. So I think for Matt to be able to just, you know, whether it's starting or coming off the bench, just kind of come in and play solid defense and be able to knock down shots. And I think it doesn't really matter what, I mean, whether starting or off the bench or what role, I think every person is committed to just doing the best that they can and impacting the game for the positive way and while they're on the court.
Is there something you guys have done in particular or that coach has done for you to prepare you for the unpredictability of this tournament?
Nolan, we'll have you answer that first, please.
Not so much. I mean, we've kind of been, you know, we were in the tournament last year and we kind of got experience from that. But, you know, you never know what you're going to get in the NCAA tournament. And, you know, coaches talked about that. And you know, playing a team that's not in our conference and we haven't played before, you got to prepare for those variables and, you know, any variables that will affect the game. So just continuing to play hard and play through, you know, different situations is kind of what we're getting ready for.
Any of you other two would like to answer that?
Yeah, I think just kind of like the past couple of weeks of our season, it's all been about, just going out and winning that one game. And, I mean, at every single game, even in conference or in, like, the SEC tournament, it's just about going out and finding a way to win that game. So someone on their team could come out and just shoot lights out, or they come in with, like, a different defensive scheme or whatever. But we'll just have to adjust to it in game the way that we have been for the past couple of weeks. And just do everything we can while we're on the court to go out and win the game.
Hi, Dave with ESPN. What have you seen on tape from Northwestern and, you know, the style of basketball they play, their personnel, and how it compares to some of the teams you faced during the season in the SEC?
Well, one thing that stands out, offensively, I mean, they have three guys on the perimeter that can all, like, really score the ball, which, I mean, that's, like, nothing really new. Like, you just got to be able to prepare to try to do the best that you can in making harder shots for those guys and making them earn all their points. I think they've kind of, defensively too, they kind of play, I guess, pretty similar to some of the teams in our conference where they're more kind of packed in as opposed to, like, pressuring out. But I like that kind of presents its own challenges, and we've had to adjust to it in previous games, and I mean, trying to come in prepared for what we're going to play. And it's always going to be different. Every single team is different. But I feel like we've kind of faced a little bit of similar challenges in conference and similar styles of play. But I mean, they're definitely a very good team being in the tournament. And you got to just make it difficult for them offensively and just prepare for their defense in terms of what actions you think you can run. But at the end of the day, it just comes down to us being able to make plays on offense and making them take tough shots on defense.
Zach Peerless, inside on you. Northwestern's been a team of runs. They had a 31-0 run against Rutgers, 22 run against Maryland. What have you noticed on those runs, and then how are you going to try to prevent them?
Yeah, I mean, they're a very high caliber offensive team, and I think they have a lot of sets that they can rely on. You know, when it comes time for them to, you know, put in 8 or 10, 12 point runs together. I think they're a very confident team right now, which has contributed a lot to that, and obviously a lot of buzz and excitement around their team. But, you know, it's just getting the little stop, or, you know, Coach Drew's talked about a lot of really small momentum changes that can really affect the change of, you know, the pace of a game. So that's something we've really gotten better at, you know, from probably mid SEC season. So, you know, whenever they go on the runs, we got to respond with a run of our own. So that's kind of been a theme of our team the last couple weeks.
For Teddy Greenstein from the Chicago Tribune, for any two of you who want to address this, what's it like playing for Coach Drew, and how was he able to help guide you guys after you got off to kind of a rough start this year?
We'll have Jeff answer that first.
I think playing for Coach Drew is awesome because he never gets too high or too low. And I think earlier in the season when we were kind of just winning one game, losing one game, and trying to fight to get above 500, he kind of stayed positive and helped us focus on staying the course in the process. And I think ultimately, that's what helped us kind of break through, is that we continue to focus on getting better. Even when we were losing, we focused on the positives then, and now it just kind of comes to fruition.
I'd say just kind of consistent preparation regardless of the results of games. I mean, there's even a part of the season where we were playing pretty good basketball, but we were just losing some games, and our practices then were the exact same as what our practices were before. And I think he's done a great job just kind of keeping our mindset correct and our perspective correct, and not like just start, you know, getting overconfident when we're winning games or just like depressed if we're losing games. So I think just kind of keeping a steady mindset and approach has definitely helped us, like, even throughout the course of a game. If another team just makes a run, then our demeanor doesn't really change, or if we just go on a big run, then you just want to extend it out even more. And I think that really kind of carries out throughout our team and not you know, succumbing to, like, any pressures during a game that can easily occur when you're emotionally invested in something.
Eddie Pels from AP. Nolan, when you transferred, I think you probably had some options, and you ended up at a pretty rigorous academic school. You went from one to another. How important was that, you know, to keep that element in your basketball career?
I mean, coming from Cornell, obviously it's a, you know, really good academic school. So, you know, that was one of the things I looked at whenever I was transferring. I wanted to, you know, go to school like Vanderbilt or Northwestern, or, you know, I wanted to kind of keep that balance in my life because I, you know, the ball stops bouncing someday. So, you know, you got to take care of your academics and you know, hopefully help yourself down the road. You know, and Vanderbilt's definitely provided that for me.
Just about the academic, you know, rigor that you have, how do you, I don't know that you know any different, but do you sometimes look at other teams that you play and go, this is a little tougher here?
I mean, yeah. I mean, Vanderbilt's definitely a tough school. And, you know, we know that, you know, our situation is probably a little bit different than a lot of student athletes, you know, across the country, just with the rigors of the academics and, you know, professors, you know, really, really challenging us, you know, not really giving us any breaks or anything like that. So, you know, it's definitely tough, especially during the season, you know, with study halls and, you know, guys having papers and, you know, and tough tests and whatnot. So, you know, it's just a balance I think we've gotten used to and, you know, something that'll probably help us down the line.
Joe Lidingham from Nashville. You guys are kind of known for a three-point shooting team. Everyone can shoot it, but do you feel like down the stretch here, at least, defense has kind of been the identity of this team?
Yeah, I definitely think so. I think that's been the biggest contributor to us turning the table or turning the page and, like, winning these games. Offensively, yeah, we've always kind of been, like, a shooting team, and that's I mean, something all of us feel confident in, but being able to, like, consistently get stops is kind of what created or led us to winning some games. Especially like last 5 minutes and some of these games against better teams we've had to rely a lot more on being able to just like get a stop, or the games come down to one last possession where we just got to get a stop and rebound, and we've been able to do that. So I think slowly like our identity has kind of changed from, I mean, just like going out to win the games, like really taking pride on defense and being able to create those stops and then like letting that turn into our offense as opposed to like trying to let offense spark like more energy on defense.
Okay, we have time for one or two more questions.
I don't know if you guys answered this already. How many times has Coach Drew showed you tape of his shot from 98, or do you guys look at it on YouTube a lot and see what he's done, and particularly on the eve of your tournament game against Northwestern?
I think when he was hired, we probably all looked up the video just to kind of get familiar with him. But since then, you know, Coach Drew hasn't mentioned it at all. I think I heard him say the other day, like, that's probably like close to before a lot of our guys were even born. So like, I think it was like 98 or something. So, you know, he doesn't really talk about it, but it was obviously a pretty sick shot.
Okay, we got time for one more question. Okay.
Ian McCaffrey, inside of you. Luke, Northwestern's not the biggest team. Their largest player is listed at 6'10", starting center, Derek Pardon, 6'8". So is that something you guys are really going to sort of try to attack tomorrow, and especially with you, 7'1", sort of this thing that you're going to really focus and sort of try to run through the offense through yourself?
I think they actually do a lot of good things to, I mean, let, like, whatever height disadvantages they have kind of be neutralized. I mean, they, like, tend to, like, double the post and just things like that, and their center himself, he's a pretty long guy. So like that's kind of his own advantage. I don't think it's something necessarily like we're just drilling it in, but it's something definitely that I have to be aware of. And we're just going to kind of consistently play offense, and whatever Coach Drew calls, we're going to run the play and see what looks we can get. But I think they do a lot of good stuff defensively just in terms of like packing it in the post doubles to try to like keep that from being, exposed. But we're just going to try to see what shots are available to us and try to take the best one on every possession. And that's kind of the goal of every offensive possession we have. So I think that's more the mindset as opposed to just, like, attacking that one aspect.
Okay, with that, we will excuse our student-athletes. Congratulations on advancing to the tournament, and good luck tomorrow.
Thank you.
Coach Rule will be up momentarily. introduce Vanderbilt head coach Bryce Drew. We'll start with an opening statement and open it up for questions. Coach Drew.
You know, we're really excited to be here. This last month's been a fantastic ride with our guys. It's a great group of young men that have really worked hard to get to this point. You know, for the Northwestern side, what a great basketball story. You know, I grew up most of my life close to Chicago, so obviously been following them closely, what Chris has been doing, and so happy and cheering for him. And then once the pairings got announced, you know, quickly switched to preparing to try to beat them. But, you know, two great schools, two great academic schools, and I know we're really looking forward to it.
Okay, we'll open up some good questions.
Coach Dave Ennett from WGN in Chicago. Can you describe the similarities you see between these two teams, and are they as similar as a lot of people think?
I definitely think there's some similarities. There's a lot of very skilled players that can shoot the ball. Both teams run a lot of different offensive actions. Both teams, you know, try to play a lot of help side defense. And so there's definitely, you know, some similarities as you go. I guess we'll see just how similar when the game starts. But they definitely, watching film, you know, we try to play, do some things that are similar.
Coach Eddie Pels from AP, you talked about two excellent academic schools. And I'm wondering, like, with your career, you know, what are the things you sort of agree to when you decide you're going to go compete in the SEC at Vanderbilt, where you may not be playing by the same rules as everybody else, or is that the case?
You know, I think that's one of the things that makes, you know, Vanderbilt, Northwestern unique places. You know, it's the student athlete has to really perform at a high level on both areas to make it at our schools. And, you know, even on this trip, you know, we have study hall, we have players that are working on homework and different things. So, you know, when we took the job, you know, we were excited to go recruit that type of student athlete that knew that they're going to have to put a lot of work in the classroom also.
Hey, Bryce, Teddy Greenstein from the Chicago Tribune. A couple questions. Do you know Chris, and how about the parallel you guys have with coaches who are dads?
You know, I've known Chris, and again, Chris has always been great to me on the road, great to me whenever we talk. You know, he sent me some encouraging texts this year. Ironically, my wife and I went to the Cubs World Series game, and we walk in, and we're getting a picture with the mascot, and here comes Chris Collins in his Cubs jersey and his wife. And so we talked a little bit there, you know, back in October. So I wish we'd got a picture all together, because that would have been good for today. But, you know, he's a great coach, but he's been really, really good to me.
Following up on that, having a dad who's such an accomplished coach, and I know you can't speak for Chris, it's an asset, but does it ever become too much pressure when you got your dad questioning things, or maybe you should have run this or should have played that guy? Does that ever come into play?
You know, they have great wisdom, so I feel like my dad has great wisdom. He's won a lot of games, and I was his assistant coach for a period of time, and he would make decisions that I didn't agree with, and about 2 weeks later, I could see why he was right. Some it took, you know, 2 or 3 months later, and I could see why he was right, and so I think now that I've gotten a little bit older, you know, I value his wisdom even more, you know, on feedback that he gives me. But he does a great job balancing, you know, when to talk, when not to talk. He knows if we lose, I'm not in a good mood. It's not a time to, you know, tell me a lot of things. He'll be here, and then he's going to fly tomorrow night to Tulsa to see my brother.
Hey, Bryce. Dan Rome from WGN. Good to see you. Because you're coaching this team, should we not be surprised that you rely so much on the three-point shot?
Well, historically, you know, since I've been head coach, our teams have not shot that many threes or shot that well. So it's really enjoyable to have a team that's shooting the ball as well as this team does and making threes. And we're a different matchup. You know, all five of our guys that start, you know, one of the best things they do is shoot three-pointers. So, you know, we could go off and make a bunch, or we could miss a bunch. And, you know, how we play sometimes is determined by our three-point shooting.
Hey, Bryce, it's Michelle Steele from ESPN. You have quite a few guys who played in the tournament last year. Obviously, this is your first year as a coach, but can you talk about the importance of that experience, tournament experience at this time of year for players?
You know, I think experience is really important, especially at the end of the year. And I think that experience helped us in the last few weeks, helped us in the SEC tournament. to make the semifinals. And some of these guys being in Dayton last year and playing in the tournament, you know, definitely you get a taste, you go through the experience of it all. So hopefully, you know, they'll be even more focused, you know, coming out tomorrow, kind of know what to expect.
Hey, Bryce, David Hoff from the Chicago Tribune. When you were at Valparaiso, look at it, you were every year, it seemed like somebody's mentioned you for as a job candidate looking around. How close did you ever come to coaching and looking at Northwestern? And then finally, what made Vanderbilt the right fit for you when you left?
Well, you know, it was a credit to our players at Valpo, how they played to be able to have opportunities, you know, to have your name even mentioned for other jobs. And obviously there's a lot of things on the internet that have gotten out in the last 5 years. But I love Vanderbilt. Nashville's a tremendous place to live. Vanderbilt, again, is one of the best universities in the country. And so, you know, my whole focus while I was at Valpo was to coach Valpo. And when I'm at Vanderbilt, to coach Vanderbilt, to try to be the best that we can be.
Coach over here, Deion Miller from ABC in Chicago. You obviously know what it's like to play the Cinderella at and the NCAA tournament. And for your guys to have that experience, but Northwestern comes in really wanting to prove that they belong. Are there challenges to facing a team like that?
You know, I think when you get to the NCAA tournament, everyone you play is going to be good. Everyone's going to be motivated. Everybody's going to be focused. Everyone's going to be at their best. And so whether it's, you know, Northwestern or anyone else, we feel like everyone wants to prove they're in and they need to go further than what people said they could go. We're not as concerned with what Northwestern's doing. You know, our focus is what we're doing and trying to negate some of the things that they want to do to be successful.
Hey, Coach, two things. One, what will make you a tough out in this tournament? And two, at one point you guys were 12-13. How'd you turn it around? Was inserting Joe key for that?
You know, the first part is defensively. When we've defended well, defended the ball, kept it out of the lane, when we've held people to lower field goal percentage, that's really helped us. And then defensive rebounding, when we haven't given up a lot of second chance points, those are kind of two indications that our team's playing good basketball. And then Joe's been spectacular. Once he went to the starting lineup, his confidence just blossomed. His play has gone way up, and he's really helped our team because he's brought some things to the table that are much needed, and he's had more of an opportunity. So he's been a big, big part of it.
Coach, you talked about being excited to recruit the kinds of players you recruit at Vanderbilt. Is there an advantage to recruiting those kinds of guys? Does it translate to basketball IQ? And how often do you find yourself recruiting against Northwestern for a kid?
You know, I've had it go both ways. I've had some of the smartest, you know, kids or even teammates when I played that I've ever been around, but they had a hard time sometimes processing the speed of the game. And then I've had some that aren't as good in the classroom that can pick up everything instantly. So I think for myself, I found that's more, you know, the person and how they handle things. And then the second part was?
Recruiting.
You know, we've maybe a couple players here and there, but I think us being in the SEC, them in the Big Ten, we haven't crossed paths too much.
Hey, Chris, Ryan Baker from WBBM in Chicago again. Tonight, are you going to pull out the shot from 98 to show your team?
well, Ryan, you know, I think the last thing is kind of like a parent, you know, and a kid. I don't think any kid wants to see what his parent did, you know, especially when they're in their teenage years. So our players definitely don't want to see any of that stuff. And I've said this before, but it wasn't even HD then. And so not being in HD, they're definitely not going to want to see that thing.
Coach, you said Joe Toy brought a lot of stuff for your team. What specifically?
Defensively, you know, his athleticism and his length on defense, he was able to get his hand on some balls. He was able to rebound and get us out in transition quickly. And offensively, he's really shot the ball well. And one game, again, the SEC tournament, he had 5 threes in the second half. And so he's given us a new dimension just with his length and his athleticism and toughness.
Chuck Culpepper from the Washington Post. You're kind of in a small national club of athletes who made plays that people have never forgotten, ever. And some of them say they get tired of it. I wonder if you've ever gotten tired of your own shot.
No, I've never gotten tired of it. And, you know, it was such a blessing for me as a person, but then also, you know, for our whole school, for our family. My brother was an assistant. My dad was the head coach. You know, when I grew up, I always wanted to play in the NCAA tournament. And so it was bedtime, and my dad would make me go to bed, and I would sneak out, and eventually he'd let me and my brother come down and watch the games. And so it was always a dream since, you know, I was very young. And so to be able to do that in the NCAA tournament, it was very, very fulfilling.
Ian McCaffrey, Inside and You. Coach, you guys have a pretty big size advantage down low, especially with Luke over Northwestern. Is that something you guys are really going to focus on in tomorrow's game?
You know, Northwestern does a great job in the post. They double the post off the catch sometimes, off the bounce other times. So they mix things up. And so Luke has been good in the post. He's been good on the perimeter. He's very skilled and he passes very well. So we'll move Luke around and kind of see how they're guarding him.
Any more questions for Coach Drew? We got one right here.
Coach, what jumps out at you when watching film about Northwestern's backcourt? Their point guard Brian McIntosh and their two wings, Vic Law, Scotty Lindsay.
You know, I recruited McIntosh and Lindsay a little bit when they were younger, and so I've seen them play, you know, for many years, and they're playing fantastic basketball. They make good decisions. They take good shots. They can score in a variety of ways, whether it's the three or pull-ups or getting to the basket. And their spacing is really, really good on offense. So, you know, it's definitely going to be a handful for us defensively to try to keep them out of the lane, but then also take away their threes.
Going to put you on the spot. Did you talk with Jim Phillips about that Northwestern job ever?
You know, that's something you'll have to ask Jim and have to ask, you know, him when you talk to him. But over the 5 years, again, there were a lot of things on the internet and different things that came up. And you know, I'm so happy for Chris and what he's doing. And obviously, I'm happy for my family and what we're doing at Vanderbilt.
Okay, any more questions for Coach Drew? Okay, Coach, congratulations on making the tournament and good luck tomorrow.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. I'm not answerable.
I would take the first one. I'm not taking the second one.
You're a veteran.
I'm just really excited about that.
It's just been a long year. We're working really hard every day. The first heat to come from fruition.
Okay, before we start our next press conference, a couple of housekeeping items again. Satellite coordinates for today's press conferences are AMC 15, K-12D. That's AMC 15, K-12D. And we ask that you make sure that your electronic devices are put on silent or vibrate, and that video recording of these press conferences is prohibited by NCAA rule. And also ask that when we point in your direction, we ask you to please raise your hand if you have a question. And we'd like you to identify yourself by your name and media affiliation as well. Please. All right, this is our 12:50 press conference with the student athletes from Gonzaga University. Joining me on the dais from left to right is senior center Shemek Karnowski, senior guard Jordan Matthews, and junior guard Nigel Williams-Goss. And we'll open it up to questions for the student athletes.
Fire up, guys, don't be scared.
Hi, Sam Adams from SWX. I don't want to start on a downer, but there was an article in The Guardian about Spokane and how Gonzaga is the shining beacon of light in this disparate town that desperately needs basketball. It was a little bit interesting, to be honest with you. I was wondering if you could tell the real world here what Spokane is like, and that it's not as bad as I guess this write-up would suggest.
Yeah, I mean, except of basketball, there's so many great things to do. I mean, I'm an outdoor guy, so, you know, I like to go out fishing, you know, stuff like hunting. You know, I think that's a great place to go to, and you'll enjoy it for sure. You know, and obviously, you know, just being there for so long, I think people can come here and experience stuff that Pacific Northwest has to offer.
Oh, yeah. Just piggybacking off what Shimmick said, just the people are so nice there. You know, I think it's been a real shock for me. You know, I've been a lot of places, and just the reception that you get when you walk down the street, and not just us as basketball players, but I just feel like, you know, it's a real sense of community in Spokane. And like he said, there's a lot of things to do outdoors, a lot of places to go hiking, you know, go to the river in the summer, go to the lakes. Stuff like that. So it's a lot to do, and the people are great. And I feel like any place with great people is a good place to be.
Corinne Copeland, AP. Nigel, what's this moment like for you guys going through this kind of historic kind of season? Is there pressure to finish it off, or is it also like your hype going through doing something that's never happened at the school before?
Yeah, we haven't really felt any pressure the entire season. You know, I just feel like we've been very goal-oriented all year. Kind of compartmentalized the season, broke it up into the non-conference, regular season, conference tournament, and now the NCAA tournament. And so far, you know, we've knocked off three out of our four goals. You know, we wanted to have a successful non-conference, did that, wanted to win the league, did that, and wanted to win the conference tournament, and also did that. So we're just excited to have an opportunity to finish off, you know, what we all came here for, and the vision that we have for ourselves to start the season. So no pressure, just really excited and ready to play.
Shem, Eddie Pels from AP. I don't know if this is a easy answer, but what was the worst part of all of the bad things about having to sit out injured last season?
I mean, first of all, just not being able to play basketball for such a long time and not being able to be with my teammates. And, you know, I had a great support system at the school, you know, starting from coaches to all my teammates and to all the people in the Gonzaga and Spokane community. But, you know, when I started doing my rehab and everything was going well, I didn't really have any big setbacks. So I was just happy to, you know, start jumping, start running, then start playing with contact. I thought those were huge steps for me. And, you know, now I'm back with the team, which I'm really happy about.
Jim Meehan, at the Spokesman Review for Shemek. They redid the math, and you're now the all-time leader for wins. What does that mean to you? That's what the game's all about, and how did you get there?
I mean, I'm really happy. I'm excited about it, but at the same time, you know, I'm just happy that whenever I play, my team wins, and that means a lot to me. And just being there on top, that says about a lot about our program and what this program is all about. It's about winning, and I think, you know, when I got there, I can give credit to all my coaches and all my teammates throughout the 5 years that I had the chance to work with.
Dave Sierra, ESPN. Do you guys get sick of hearing that your conference isn't as strong as maybe some of the other conferences out there? And does that help, you know, especially at a time like this in the season, motivate you to prove a lot of doubters wrong that you really are a very, very good team?
We'll have Jordan answer first, please.
I mean, you're going to hear the noise. I mean, when we were undefeated, everybody always had something to say. That's just the nature of sports. Someone's always going to have something negative to say about you. Like I said earlier, if we save the world, someone will complain we didn't do it fast enough. So just staying ready and just staying focused and staying within our inner core of guys and not listening to the outside noise. And it hasn't affected us at all.
Brad Rock from the Deseret News in Salt Lake. Jordan, you know, Gonzaga for many years has been the little guy playing big teams. So are you one program that can look at this kind of game and say, we have to watch out? Because for many years, you guys were on the other end of the spectrum.
Right, and it's new for us. I mean, Nigel and I transferred. Shem's obviously been here 5 years, but we approach every game like that. We never look down on a team or look at them like, okay, this is going to be easy for us. South Dakota State's a great team, and all the teams we've played have had different weapons that have come at us. So it's not one of those things where we're looking at like, oh, we're the big dog now. That chip is still the same. So we just got to come out, compete, and do what we do.
Justin Reed, Gonzaga Bulletin. This is for Shem. What makes Mike Dom so good? And going through this whole week, looking at his tape, what is the key to slowing him down?
You know, he's a great offensive player. You know, he's a big guy who can basically score from anywhere on the court, starting from 3-point line, of the dribble, going to the basket, back to the basket. So, you know, we practice a couple of other ways that we're gonna guard him in practice. I cannot share that, but we'll be ready for tomorrow.
Any more questions for our student athletes? Okay, gentlemen, thank you for coming up, and congratulations and good luck tomorrow. Thank you. Gonzaga head coach Mark Few will follow at 1:05 p.m. Okay, I'd like to introduce Gonzaga head basketball coach Mark Few. He will begin with an opening statement, then we'll open up for questions. Coach Few.
Hey, it's great to be invited back to the tournament. I think this is our 19th straight. We're very proud of that streak we have, and it's something that means everything to the program, and this team's done just an amazing job all year of putting us in position night in and night out to earn their way back to what I think, and I think our team thinks, is the greatest sporting event in the world. So hopefully we can come out and play well.
Okay. Questions for Coach Few.
Mark Ovenden from KDLT in Sioux Falls. How dangerous is it for you guys to be playing a 16 seed that basically has nothing to lose?
That's one of the tough aspects of the tournament, where this isn't a 7-game series where I think we'd be fine. This is a 1-game, one night, and they have some very, very capable, talented players, dangerous players, and they're a hot team. They've won, I think, 6 or 7 in a row, and so it's 40 minutes. That's why you roll into this tournament. We got to be good on Thursday morning, Thursday afternoon. I think that's what makes this tournament so special.
Mark, Eddie Pels from AP. The whole thing about it's always good to get the loss under your belt. I guess that's easy to say now, but at the time.
Didn't feel like it at the time.
Did you get anything out of that? Or?
It's really hard to say. One of my friends and people that I lean on and talk to, he said, we won't know for 4 or 5 weeks whether it was a positive thing or a negative thing. I don't know how you would. The thought that everybody was running around with prior to that, it'd be good for them to lose was, I just thought that was ludicrous. You don't ever coach or think about losing a game, especially when you're in that position. But, we chose to just take the positives out of it, and understand we have a process in place, and 29 times prior to that game, we had, stuck with the process and crossed the T's, dotted the I's, and did our jobs. We kind of deviated from the process. It cost us that one game, and it's been nice to get back, back on track and doing what we're supposed to be doing.
Kareem Copeland, AP. Mark, does the tournament have a different feel as a number one and as the program has evolved and your goals have increased over the years from, I guess, years ago when you guys were more of an upstart team?
Oh, no question. Yeah, no question. We came in, much like the question in the back, we had guns a-blazing, nothing to lose, and especially that first run to the Elite Eight. It was all new to us, and we were excited and giddy and felt like we were playing with house money, but now it's more measured, leveled, and we know we got a job to do, and we got to take care of the job. But then I also think it's my job, our staff's job, to make sure that we are still having fun, and we're 18 to 22 year old, guys that are that need to be excited, need to show emotion, and need to these are the best days of their lives, and they need to enjoy it. So we have talks about that a lot. Just to add that, it's really no different than our seasons have very much became like that also now too. They start out with very high expectations, and then they continue to build and build and build, and so it's very much kind of on a plane with that.
Aaron Falk with the Salt Lake Tribune. After that loss, was there someone on your team in your locker room, whether it's you or a player, who kind of takes the reins and regroups and gets those guys back on track?
It's basically my job, but we have a great system slash organization at Gonzaga, from me down to my assistants, down all the way the players are very much involved, and we got some good leaders this year. And so, I mean, it was everybody, you know, but starts at the top.
Hi, Coach. Sam Adams from KHQ in Spokane. I'm sure you haven't had a chance to read it, but there was an article, it wasn't very flattering, about the city of Spokane from The Guardian. It basically talked about how Spokane is a struggling town, I'm paraphrasing here, and Gonzaga, for lack of a better word, is the only thing going for it. As a person who knows and loves Spokane, could you please kind of let people out there maybe know about your perspective on how great the city is?
Wow, I thought this was a basketball press conference, so we're going into social issues. I have no idea what you're talking about or what the article is, but Spokane's a phenomenal place to live and call home. It's been, I mean, it's one of the big keys to you know, this ascension of Gonzaga. I mean, it happened in a city that the people there are so loyal and so so eager to have, you know, something you know, that they can root for and pull for, and but I mean, I find it to be a phenomenal place to live, just with all the outdoor recreation and activities and the climate. The only bad time of year is, you know, when we're in the gym 6.5 days. Ironically, it starts warming up right when the kind of the season gets over, and it starts cooling down right when the season starts. So I find it to be a phenomenal place to raise a family, to have a basketball program to bring back home, and seems to me like it's booming right now, business-wise and building-wise and all that. So I don't know who wrote it, or must be fake news.
Matt Zimmer, Sioux Falls Argus leader. Coach, what are your impressions of Mike Dom, and how does he compare to some of the better big men that you face?
Wow, really, really impressed with Mike Dom, and totally reminds me of Kyle Wilcher. I mean, just scores the ball so easy, ball goes in, never seems to get rattled, has the ultimate green light, has great confidence. Shooting out to 28 feet is not a problem, and nor is it maybe a bad shot. And then he actually has a little bit, you can get going downhill a little bit like Adam Morrison could. So, and he has a high shooting pocket like Mo had. So we've got some good, you know, kind of guys that we've had over the years that are pretty good, you know, like type players.
Coach Elliott, Nathan, KSFY Sports. Coach, you guys mentioned the 19 consecutive tournament appearances. NCSU has made 4 in the last 6 to help kind of raise the profile of mid-major basketball in the Midwest. What have you seen out of their program, and how have you guys kind of built the model that in some ways they're following?
I mean, well, I always cringe kind of when everybody, you know, when they, you know, want to be the next Gonzaga or do this or do that. I think every situation is unique. We've been in a, you know, just an incredible growth mode since that first day, and, you know, we made it in 99, and the school has been incredibly on board with that. As I said, the city of Spokane has been phenomenal and a great launching pad for that. So, I mean, every situation is unique, but that being said, yes, South Dakota State has done a great job with building on their success. You know, you could tell in that conference tournament, their guys kind of understood it was March now, and it's time. This is what we do, kind of, and we win these things and move on. They just had a look of a team like that. Anytime you get your program or your team to that point where they kind of, you know, expect to win those games and start, you know, chomping at the bit to get going deeper into March, that's a good thing.
David Brown from Midco Sports Network in Sioux Falls. You sort of alluded to it earlier, the one game versus a seven game type of series, but no matter how much you ignore it, people will look at the 1 by your name and the 16 by South Dakota State's name. Yep. Do you discuss being the top seed? Does seeding matter, or do you kind of just have that old cliche of throw the numbers out the window?
Well, they do. The number's not going to get us another basket. It's not going to get us another rebound. It's not going to get us another stop. So, you know, once we get through all this stuff, then it just turns into a basketball game tomorrow at noon, and guys got to play, and guys got to make plays, and we got to stick to our process and win those aspects that we talk about within our program.
Coach Carter Williams from KSL.com here in Salt Lake. The last time this team was a one seed, it was here in Salt Lake City. Was there any experience from being a one seed before that kind of helps out to be it again?
Well, I don't know that any of these guys were even on that team or around. I mean, Shem might have been. He's been here for a while, but it was kind of a minor role. So certainly none of these guys have been part of that. The thing that I told them is they need to just be prepared for, you know, it's probably going to be a road type environment. It's just the nature of, you know, sports and everybody likes to root for underdogs. And if you're the number one, there's not going to be a whole lot of people out there rooting for you except the Gonzaga people. So, just be prepared for that. We've been great on the road all year, and just understand we need to come out with that kind of a hardened exterior and play great.
I guess kind of just following up on that, I mean, I know you're a favorite, but do you think you don't get a little bit of love because you're Gonzaga and you're not, Duke?
Well, we're not Duke. I mean, we're not. I mean, I'm not even close to Coach K. So, look, I mean, nobody could have given us any more respect than a neutral group of people granting us a number one seed, you know, a national group of basketball, you know, people on a committee gave us a number one seed in this tournament. So I don't think we need to look for anything more than that. But like I said, that's great, and we'll be able to look back on this and you know, it's another notch in the belt. We've already done it one time, but now to follow it up and do it again is something that I think everybody associated with the program should be proud of. But you know, again, after today, it just doesn't matter, man. It's we got to play. We got to play.
Kareem Copeland, AP. Mark, what have you either done with the guys, or what is it about them that they've been able to kind of stay so focused throughout this kind of historic run? Because it's very easily when you have these expectations to, you know, just have an off night.
Yeah, that's a great question, because I think that's one of the other things with this team that has just been truly remarkable. And I've been blessed to have some great groups of guys and great teams, but these guys really haven't had, you know, a bad night. They've been really, really focused. We had that bad, you know, 10-minute stretch against BYU, but we also came out to the start of that game and I think led 20-4. We were raring to go. So I on the road in the dog days of January, February, these guys have been focused in games where maybe you might see them have their guard down, where they were heavy favorites and they weren't. And I think that's been really impressive, and it literally speaks volumes about their focus, their attention to detail, and their ability to just, you know, on game night to rise up and make sure we're doing what we're supposed to be doing. But it's rare. I mean, like I've said, some of my best teams have, you know, had those nights where they don't even look like your team. You're like, who the hell is this?
Any more questions for Coach Few?
Okay. All right,
Coach.
Thanks.
Congratulations and good luck tomorrow.
Yep.
Gonzaga will be the one seed taking on South Dakota State, the 16 seed tomorrow at 12 noon. That game will be broadcast on TBS. Next press conference will be at 1:35 with the student athletes from Northwestern University.
you see a hand go up, then I'll point to it. But yeah, just keep an eye on. Okay, keep an eye on me.
Trying to direct you guys as best I can without making any noise.
As we get ready for the 1:35 press conference with the Northwestern student athletes, reminder that Northwestern is the number 8 seed. They'll be playing the number 9 seeded Vanderbilt Commodores at approximately 2:30 tomorrow afternoon. That game will be broadcast live on TBS. Chris Collins. C-O-L-L-I-N-S. You're welcome. Northwestern comes in with a record of 23-11 as an at-large selection out of the Big Ten Conference. And first ever NCAA tournament bid, so a little bit of history tomorrow too. What's that? Sure. Oh my gosh, it's Woody. I was like going, hey Woody, what's up? I'll come by and see you in a sec. I'm keeping the seat warm for Bill. Yeah. And once again, the reminder on the satellite coordinates for today's press conferences. Satellite coordinates are AMC 15, K12D. That's AMC 15, K12D. So if you, a reminder also, if you have a question, please raise your hand and we'll bring the microphone to you, and please identify yourself by name and by affiliation. I'd like to welcome student athlete representatives from Northwestern University. From my left to right is senior guard Sanjay Lumpkin and junior guard Brian McIntosh. And we'll now open it up for questions for our student athletes.
Sanjay, I don't want to make you feel old, but it's been over five and a half years since you committed here.
Yeah.
How do you feel that you've grown during those 5 years as a person and as a teammate?
You know, it has been an unbelievable ride. You know, been here since the year 2012, and you know, it's awesome to, you know, be here now and, you know, being a fifth-year senior captain of the team. I feel like I've really seen these guys grow, and it's really rewarding for me to, you know, to see that. And I feel like I've definitely grown as a player. I've you know, progressed every season, and I feel like I've really grown the most as a leader. You know, just being there for the younger guys, and you know, being that rock of the team, and you know, doing whatever's necessary for us to win.
Hi guys, Steve Greenberg from the Chicago Sun-Times. For both of you, have you been practicing your act like you've been there before faces?
How are we doing? No, I think we're just trying to take all this in and enjoy the moment. But after the celebration on Selection Sunday, it was time for us to get back to work and prepare to win a game. So I think that's kind of where our focus has been. So maybe we are locked in and we don't seem too excited, but deep down we are. We're enjoying it.
Yeah, I would say for all of us, you know, we're obviously enjoying the moment, and you know, just enjoying, you know, this opportunity. This is an opportunity that you know, we have now right in front of us, and you know, we can't take it for granted. It may never come again, and it won't come for me because it's my last season. But you just, everyone's got to enjoy this while we're here, and now that we are here, we got to work, and you know, we want to stay here.
Aaron Falk with the Salt Lake Tribune. Sanjay, now that you've been there the whole time, but what kind of changes has Coach Collins brought to you guys? I mean, what's brought this sort of turnaround for your program?
I mean, it started right away when he first got, you know, to the program. I knew it was evident that the, you know, the culture was going to change along the entire program. You know, it started with, you know, the first day he got here, his passion and the belief he instilled in all of us. And, you know, I can confidently say that's why we're here today. And it took a group of committed guys. It's a long road. You know, not everyone made it. It took guys to, you know, believe in him and believe in everything that we had going. And it was a, you know, it's awesome ride. It's everything. You know, being here now has made everything that was put into this, you know, worth it. And so many people have done a lot of things for it. And we're not just doing this for ourselves and, you know, for our team. We're doing this for everyone that also has something to do with it. All the, you know, people like Jim Stack, Billy McKinney, Drew Crawford, Sean Cherno, so many guys like that, and that were, you know, part of the foundation for this program. And, you know, we just want to finish everything off right.
Hey guys, Dave Revson from the Big Ten Network. Just curious, given the fact that this has been the stated goal for so long, it's the reason that each one of you committed, obviously to different coaches, but what does it feel like to have climbed that mountain, to have achieved that goal that you thought about every day, that you talked about every day, and that everyone collectively was working toward?
You know, I would say it was first of all surreal for, you know, a lot of us to, you know, hear our name called. You know, we all came here to be a part of a different Northwestern and, you know, be a part of history, and we achieved that goal. And you know, now that we are here, we want to do everything we can to stay here. And, you know, this is not just the, you know, the end goal for Northwestern basketball. You know, this is, we see this as the, you know, the starting point, you know, a new standard that can be set for our program. And, you know, it's been a magical year. It's been awesome. None of us want the season to end. And it's been awesome.
Yeah, I think we can't emphasize enough that this isn't the end goal. Like, it's one of our goals is to make the tournament, but it's, you know, we're not just satisfied to be here. We're going to go out and try and win a game and continue playing, playing for our lives just to continue this season on. So it's been such a special year that you don't want to see it end. And that's why it's just a single goal, not the end goal.
David Hoffman, the Chicago Tribune. Both of you guys, what's the best advice that you've gotten this week in terms of how to deal with all the hype that's surrounding this arrival here?
I mean, I think the best advice was what Coach Collins told us. He talked about Dan Marino and how when they lost in the Super Bowl, how they thought that they were going to get back there many times and that they would have many opportunities, many chances, and they never made it back. Coach talked about how, you know, that we have an opportunity right in front of us and, you know, we just have to take it. And, you know, we may never get to this point. You can't take anything for granted. And, you know, we all can put everything we have left in the tank into this. And everyone's invested in this. And we just have to give it everything we have.
Yeah, and on top of that, it's just enjoying the moment. That's a lot of what the talk has been about. It's so hard to get here, obviously, especially for our program never being here. Just enjoy the moment. Don't, while be locked in and try and prepare and win games, but also, you know, enjoy what you've accomplished and take it all in.
Josh Furlong, KSL.com. Obviously, guys haven't played a game yet, but what have you guys done to kind of experience this, you know, NCAA tournament, and is that, and what are you doing to kind of keep your minds off of the actual game in that regard?
So we, you know, flew in yesterday, and we were able to get a practice in. It was, you know, great to just get away from everything at Northwestern. I mean, obviously, it's been great atmosphere there and everything, but it has been a lot of media, a lot of distraction. Get up here, get some good practice in, get focused in, locked in on, you know, what we have going on here. And, you know, we've got a good meal as a team, and we've just been, you know, locked in on the game. And we had some time to, you know, prepare for tomorrow. And we're, you know, we're just fully locked in.
Dave Sura, ESPN. How would you guys characterize the matchup against Vanderbilt? There are appears to be some similarities between the two schools. What are you guys seeing?
Yeah, they're a really disciplined team. They execute. Their defense is similar to the way we defend. So it'll be a lot like playing ourselves. They're a very good team, and they could give us a lot of problems with the way they shoot the ball. They're a very skilled three-point shooting team, 1 through 5. So, you know, we've compared it to, you know, guarding a team like a Michigan in our league, just looking for similarities. But we have a tough task on our hands, and just looking for the ball to be tipped off and kind of get it rolling. I think we're all just excited. We've prepared really well, and now we're just ready to go play.
Eddie Pels from AP. I'd ask this to both of you. Obviously, Northwestern's reputation as an academic school is, we all know it. What kind of things would you imagine you have to deal with that maybe the average guy at another Big Ten school maybe doesn't?
I would say academically, Northwestern is, you know, extremely challenging. We have guys right now that are working on getting extensions to their finals or typing papers, because we're on the quarter system, so our finals are during this week. And I would say that's a challenge that not everyone has to face. But, you know, Northwestern prepares us right. They take care of us with tutors. They get us the help. They do everything possible to, you know, allow us to focus on basketball as much as we can. But we try to do the best in both categories. And it's definitely something that is a little different at Northwestern, but, you know, it's not a, you know, doesn't affect how we play.
Yeah, I would just, building off that, you can't give enough credit to our academic advisors and our athletic department and trying to help us as much as they can with our schoolwork, especially during this week. This is a tough week for us with our finals, and then obviously all of this attention and media and preparation going into this week and weekend. So can't give enough credit to them, and now it's just our job to do the work and prepare to do something special.
This is for Bryant. It's been a long-held notion. I don't know if it's actually truer in the tournament than ever, you know, during the regular season, but that point guards are, you know, this is the time for them to shine. And you think every year, Archie Diacono, Marcus Page last year. But as you grew up watching the tournament, was it part of your dream to not only participate but to have the ball in your hands, to close a game with free throws, to be that point guard? And do you recall any particular guys in that vein who really meant a lot to you as you grew up in the game?
Yeah, I think that is the narrative in this tournament is the point guard play can win you games and take you far. And I always look to, the recent guys, Ryan Archidiakono, Marcus Page was also a good one, but also you look at like the smaller schools, the CJ McCollum, like just good guard play that was able to win. I took a lot from John Shire at Duke when they were able to win the national championship. I thought he played really well during the whole tournament. And that's something you dream about and having the ball in your hands. And, it's something that Coach Collins expects me to be able to do is help us finish a game and make the right plays and make winning plays. So it's an exciting time, but it's not a lot of pressure on me. We have a really good team, but obviously I'm a guy that wants the ball in my hands at the end of a game.
George Smith, Fox 32, Chicago, for both of you guys. Vandy's been known to shoot lights out, big guys, little guys. So how critical is perimeter defense, and how much of a challenge do they present?
Yeah, all their guys, I think we talked about their starters, all have 40-plus threes each on the season. And, a lot of it obviously comes with the shooting ability, but a lot of it comes with guarding the ball. They like to get in the paint and kick it out for threes, and we got to be just extremely disciplined guarding the perimeter and have great communication. There's going to be a lot of people in the stands tomorrow, and we're going to really have to talk some things out, and it's going to come down to that.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Just our communication is going to be very important and vital, and if we're going to be able to win this game, just because they can give us a lot of difficulties with their five men that can stretch the floor and knock down open threes, and also their guards. We have to do a great job on the ball and keeping them out of the paint. And it's going to be a tough task, but, defense wins championships, right? So that's the one thing we've talked about in the locker room is our defense has to be really good in order for us to move on in this tournament.
Do you have time for a couple more questions?
Brian, Bryce Drew talked about recruiting you early in the process when he was at Valparaiso. What do you recall from that experience and your interaction with him?
Yeah, terrific coach and runs a great system. And he's one of the household names in Indiana, obviously, with his shot. And just also as a high school basketball player. So it was really special to hear from him. And was never able to take a visit. Was scheduled a couple and just was never able to get on campus. Just conflict with our schedules. But, yeah, just being able to hear from him was special. Indiana guy, like I said. So, it's kind of odd that you're going to play against a guy like that in the NCAA tournament.
Sanjay, knowing that this could be your final game, how does the preparation change, and then how does it stay the same?
Knowing it could be my final game doesn't really change anything for me. I just prepare the same as I would for any game. Obviously, I knowingly know that that's a possibility, but just play as a regular game and can't get out of character. Can't do anything crazy because it could be my last game. Just stay in my role and just leave it all out there. If I can, knowing that if I know I left it all out there and did whatever I can do, and I got to live with that and whatever the result may be, and just enjoy it.
Okay. Thank you and congratulations. We'll excuse our student athletes and best of luck tomorrow.
Thank you.
Coach Collins will be up momentarily.
appreciate it.
At this time, we'll introduce Northwestern head coach Chris Collins. We'll have him begin with an opening statement and open up for questions, coach.
Well, it goes without saying, we're really excited to be here. Really proud of this team. We've earned our way in here by the way we've played this year, and just excited to play against a really tough, well-coached, good Vanderbilt team. You know, to me, there's a lot of similarities in the two teams. You got good kids who play hard, play together. And if you look at their body of work, especially over the last month of the season, they've played some outstanding basketball with some big-time wins, and we know what's going to be ahead of us. They're very disciplined. They spread you out. They can really shoot the ball, and they feast on teams that make mistakes against them, especially defensively. If you don't communicate well, if you're not locked in, you know, they're going to find the open guy, and they're, you know, especially at the three-point line, they can be devastating when they get it going from there. So it's going to be a tough challenge tomorrow, but our guys are – we've had a couple days to really lock in on preparation, kind of get through the hoopla and excitement of all the selection show and things like that, and get back to work on the practice floor, and we're here to try to win the game, and we know what's at stake, and you got to be at your best this time of year because everyone is really good.
Any questions for Coach Collins?
Hey, Chris. Teddy Greenstein, Chicago Tribune. Bryce Drew said you and he saw each other at a Cubs World Series game. I guess that'd be game four. Recall that moment if you can, and what your relationship with him is.
Yeah, well, I mean, Bryce and I have been friends for a long time. You know, I've known him since he's been in high school. I've known his family, his father, someone I really respect, known his brother, obviously, too. And, you know, we have a lot in common. So we've always kind of connected because we come from basketball families. Our dads were coaches. We grew up in gyms and in the game. And so we've always kind of connected on that level and gotten along really well. It was pretty funny, actually. I don't think he recognized me at first because I had a full uniform on that night. So he was dressed all nice, you know. He had a nice shirt on and slacks. I had my Cubs jersey on, my hat on backwards. I might have had some eye black on. I'm not sure, but he kind of did a double take, like when I went and said hello to him. But it's pretty funny. We were with our wives, and I wish we would have taken a group photo if we would have known this would happen. But we each took our photos with our wives with Clark the Cub, and gave each other a little hug, yelled "Go Cubs," and kept it moving. But it was it's funny to think about that now.
Chris, Ryan Baker from CBS2 Chicago. Back to the connection between you and Bryce being coaches' kids, and I asked him this, you know, for you being a first-time head coach, does it ever become? I mean, your dad is involved, but has he ever become too involved, or how is that situation for him with so much experience and input and that he's had on you being like your first mentor in being a head coach?
Yeah, it's actually, I've been very fortunate. You know, my personal experiences with my dad is at the end of the day, he wants to be my dad. So he's had a great way of, if he ever senses that, you know, he's overstepping his bounds or doing, he backs off, you know, and if he does come to practice, he's never on the floor. He goes up in the seats, and when practice is over, our guys go and talk to him and listen to all the old stories, and he's kind of like the grandpa to all of them, which he loves. But he's been great. He never tries to do anything with X's and O's. The thing that he's really helped me with is kind of the program building. You know, for my dad, every situation he took over in the NBA was a rebuild, you know, was a team that was struggling, that needed to change a culture and find a winning attitude and a winning way. And so he had great advice with those things, you know, the things that we've had to do over the past 4 years to kind of get ourselves to that winning mindset. So I'm very fortunate that at the end of the day, he's my dad. When I played, he didn't try to coach me. He always tried to get me around really good coaches, because he didn't want to do anything to upset the father-son relationship. And I think because of that, our relationship is great. And I really admire for him the way he's handled me with those things. He'll be here tomorrow, which is exciting.
Coach, Eddie Pels from AP. What, obviously, you had a lot of things you needed to change at Northwestern. I know it's a really strong academic school, so what were the advantages and disadvantages of that, I guess, as you tried to build a program?
Yeah, I tried to really focus when I first took over on the advantages versus the disadvantages. Obviously, we had some disadvantages. You know, there wasn't a history of winning and tradition, and you know, we were in the process of kind of, which we are doing now, redoing all of our facilities and all those things, and maybe the perception of the program wasn't that great when it came to basketball. But I tried to focus on the things that were positive. You know, the fact we were in the Big Ten, the fact we were at a great academic school that could offer, you know, the best of both worlds for young men out there. And also where we are, you know, right outside of Chicago, the resources of what the city brings and the beautiful campus and all those. I thought we had a lot to kind of build off with that. Then it was our mission and our to change the mindset of what people thought of Northwestern basketball. And, you know, there had to become a culture of work. You know, that was the first thing. You know, I wanted to have guys that wanted to be great basketball players and great students. You know, there's no reason why can't you want both? You know, and so that's what we wanted. We wanted guys that wanted to be at a place like Northwestern for everything that it had to offer, not just the academics, not just the basketball, but both. And, you know, fortunately for us, we were able to go out in the first year and get a great core of guys that have represented the foundation of our program, you know, with Bryant McIntosh, Vic Law, Scotty Lindsay, and Gavin Skelly. And we've kind of built off of them with the two seniors of Taphorn and Lumpkin. And little by little, you know, you see some of the changes occur, you know, and it doesn't happen overnight. And the hardest part during the whole thing was the last thing that kind of turns the corner are the wins and losses. You know, there were so many wins I was seeing behind the scenes with how our guys were working, how they were training, their attitudes, their commitment. But we couldn't get over the hump with the wins. And it really took into last year with the 20-win season and then carry over into this year to kind of really get over the hump with learning how to win in tough situations and big moments.
Hey, Chris. Hey. Michelle from ESPN. I wanted to talk a little bit about the altitude. You know, obviously playing in the Big Ten, you don't get an opportunity that much to play in this kind of altitude. Has that changed your approach to practice? And is there anything that your staff is doing maybe extra with the guys to counteract that?
Well, we're trying to keep them as hydrated as possible. That's always very important. And we've got a great team of trainers and doctors and all that are on top of all of that. But I think the main thing was we were able to get out here yesterday afternoon. We were able to get a good workout in. You know, I thought our guys, long flight, all that, it really helped us for today, and I think it'll really help us for tomorrow, being able to get in here and kind of get our feet underneath us, get a good sweat, get a good workout, kind of take all that in. And so I think after a couple days, I don't think it's as big a factor, and especially if you don't let it be a factor. You know, I think it's a lot of times some of that can be a mindset. You know, if in this time of year, you shouldn't let anything cloud your mind, you know, what can be a distraction towards playing really well, because in an NCAA tournament format, you gotta play at your best, and you got 40 minutes, and if you don't, you're going home. So there's a sense of urgency on every possession.
Hey, Chris. Vinny Duber, CSN hey, Vin. Chicago. Vic has mentioned a few times this season about how when he committed, he had people asking him, why did you pick Northwestern? I'm sure you had some of that when you took the job. Mm-hmm. Has it felt like vindication for you guys to those people who were questioning why you could do this?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if it's vindication. I just, you know, in my heart, I always believed that this could be really good. You know, I just did. I grew up 10, 15 miles from the campus. I'd been on the campus. I knew it was gorgeous. I played my final high school game in that arena, and it was packed. It was sold out. It was an electric atmosphere. And I just always thought with the location, the kind of school, I just thought if you kind of got the right guy in there and you could get the right players, you know, I thought it could become something special. I did, and maybe a lot of people didn't, but I believed. And then my mission was to go out. I can't play anymore. You know, all I can do is stand over the sideline and call plays and run practices. I needed to find players that believe the way I did. And Vic was the first guy, and it was a monumental recruit for us. He was a local product, Chicago kid. It kind of instantly, he had the perception in the city as being a very good prospect and a recruit, was recruited by a lot of top programs. For him to kind of have the courage to say, you know what, I see something in this coach, I see something in this program, it really got the ball rolling for us to start what we've been able to build over the last 4 years.
Dave.
Chris, Dave Revson for the Big Ten Network. obviously, and you know, I asked this of Sanjay and Brian too, and you know, they talked about wanting to win, and I get that. Obviously, you're not here just to be here, but what does it mean to be here? I mean, the fact that you kind of had this uphill slog here for 4 years trying to do something that so many people told you couldn't be done, and now you have arrived. What are the emotions that have gone through as you stepped off that plane with these kids yesterday?
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's special. I mean, it's, I said it on Sunday afterwards. I mean, for all of us, I mean, how many times in any of our lives do you get a chance to do something historical that has never, ever been done? And these guys have, you know, this group has, they're the first ones. And hopefully it's just, to me, it's not an end game though. I talk about that too. It's, I want this to be the beginning of our program, you know, and hopefully the sign of more success and more, you know, NCAA tournaments. But there's no question, the first time is special. The first selection show you watch when you see your name, it's special. And I want them to be excited. I want them to feel that they've done something really good. And the thing I love about this group, though, is once kind of all that passed from Sunday into Monday, they've really locked in now to wanting to win here. You know, it's they don't just want to be here and show up and go home. I mean, it's nice to be invited to the party. It's nice to be invited to the dance, all those things. But you want to stay for a little while. And to do that, you got to go out and win. But I think we're going to really get reflective when it's all over. You know, I think right now you're in a whirlwind. You're practicing. You're preparing. You're getting ready to play. You know, I think, you know, when this is all done, whenever that may be, we hope to extend it as far as we can. I think that's when we can all really get reflective and really be proud of the accomplishments that this team did, a lot of historical moments, a lot of milestones that have never happened at our school in our history.
Chris, David Hoff from Chicago Tribune. So Bryant was talking about how you actually have players who are working on final papers this week. Are you aware of that?
Yeah, sure.
How real is that challenge? And how have you been able to manage, you know, the biggest week of their athletic careers with the academic reality?
Yeah, I mean, it's for us, we're on a quarter system academically, so this is finals week. So fortunately, there are a lot of our players, there's a couple guys that have exams, but most of the guys are final papers. So on the plane, on our off time, you know, we have our academic advisor here working with the guys, and, you know, they're students too. I mean, that's the reality of this. They're student athletes, so you know, trying to manage getting them their rest, but also doing their schoolwork and locking into game prep. It's something we've talked about since we were selected on Sunday, and something I admire about these guys because, you know, we're at a place where, you know, you do have to go to school, and so is Vanderbilt. I mean, you know, it's a great school as we are, and these guys do have to go to class. They do have to write their papers. They do have to take the tests, and our guys are really diligent about wanting to do well in school. So, it has been a different week for me. You know, in my experiences, a lot of these schools are on spring break right now. So, and that was always my experience when I was at Duke. So this has been different for me as well, trying to manage all that. But I've been really proud about how our guys have done this week. And we'll be ready to go. We'll be rested. They've done a good job. We'll get a good night's sleep tonight. And we'll be ready to go come 2:30 or whenever the tip is tomorrow.
Hi, Chris. Steve Greenberg from the Chicago Sun-Times. It's not your first time at a podium and a press conference and all that, but I wonder if it's your first time at an NCAA tournament podium. You probably did it as a player. Did you? Probably not as an assistant coach, right?
No.
So, what do you remember about that day, that time in your life? How you felt? How it felt to, you know, sit up there and be a spokesman?
Yeah. No. It's and all that? Well, it's exciting. You know, it's what you dream about as a kid. I mean, I'm at the end of the day, too, I still have a lot of little kid in me. You know, it's like wearing my jersey at the Cub World Series game. I think it's one of my strengths. And, you know, when I was a kid, every year, whenever the tournament came out, I would write up the brackets and I would go outside by myself and I would play the whole tournament every game just by myself. And I would announce both teams and I knew all the players. And every game came down to a buzzer shot and, you know, make or miss that other team won. And I'd write it in and I'd play the whole tournament for hours. So, you know, my dream in life was to be a part of this. You know, I always wanted to be on One Shining Moment. You know, when I was a player, that was one of my biggest dreams, is maybe I could be on that video one day. And so going through it as a player, especially in 94, we went to the national championship game. I was a starter on a team. So going through that run, through all the rounds, and see the media grow and the excitement and the open practices, those were dreams come true. And I'm sure it is for a lot of our guys right now. I mean, for them to be up here and for them to do the open practice soon and be out there with people here. And, you know, it's things you dream of as a kid, and I think that's a good thing. You know, I think that's very healthy, that's very positive. And that's why you do it. I mean, that's why you work hard, to be in these moments and hopefully see your hard work pay off to do these kinds of things.
Okay, we have time for a couple more questions.
Deion Miller from AC7 in Chicago. You mentioned how you guys have handled things so well, but obviously there will be nerves tomorrow. Do you feel you have to do anything, say anything to kind of calm that, you know, lack of a better description, like Hoosiers measure the basket, like it's the same stage, guys. It's all the same.
Yeah, I mean, I'll play that by ear. I mean, I've always been a coach to coach on instincts and gut feel, and you know, you always need to take the temperature of your team and kind of see how they're at. If they're really fired up, if you see they're ready, you say less. You know, if you feel like they're a little bit jittery or they're a little bit quiet in the locker room, maybe you do a little bit more rah-rah. And, you know, I'll feel that out tomorrow as we get up, as we get over here and kind of take a temperature of the locker room and see where they're at. We do have great leadership. We do have veterans. But every team in the NCAA tournament have nerves. I don't care who you are, what your seat is. Everybody's a little bit nervous. So I think it's important, the beginning of the game, you know, can you find a way to get a layup? You know, can you get a turnover, something to see the ball going, you know, something to break the ice where, okay, now we're playing ball. You know, because there's no question that first minute for all these kids and on every team. I mean, I remember as a player, your heart's in your throat, you get tired really quick because your nervous energy. And then, you know what, after a couple of possessions, you settle in and you kind of forget about where you are. You're just playing basketball. And hopefully we'll be able to do that quickly and get off to a good start tomorrow.
Hey, Coach, Zach Peerless, Inside NU. The first guy that you hugged, it seemed, after you guys were selected was Sanjay. Mm-hmm. For a guy who's been here for so long, what has he meant not only for you as you've grown this program and then for the program overall, just what has he meant?
Yeah, I mean, Sanjay's our rock, you know, and it's he's such a selfless guy because you look at our stats and he's never going to be the leading scorer. Stats aren't going to jump off the page, but he's an indispensable part of our program and our team. You know, he's our leader. He brings his effort, his heart, his emotion every time he steps on the floor. And for 5 years, I mean, when I first got here, you know, even before Taphorn got here, he was there when we started those spring workouts when I first got the job in April of 2013. And so when this all started, he was there, and I am so happy that he's a captain on the first team that's been able to do this, because he deserves it, because he's put everything of himself into this program. He's put his individual agenda aside in order for us to win, to be a stopper, to be a rebounder, to be a glue guy. And I'm just so proud of him. You know, I love him, and it's been a great 5 years having him on my side.
Okay, Coach. Thank you for your time.
All right, thank you guys. See you tomorrow.
Our next press conference will be held at 3:45 with the St. Mary's student athletes, followed by head coach Bennett at 4 p.m. You might be the only one. I said you might be the only one. Thank you.